Hello everyone, I'm going to do a problem from mathematical modelling in the calculus course, and don't forget that calculus was invented to sort of solve problems like planetary motion. So the idea is to set up, in this case, a differential equation so that we can then solve it and answer a practical problem. One of the things we have to do with modelling is to convert words into mathematics, and sometimes that can be a bit tricky, but I'll try and help you as we go along. So the basic problem here is that we have an object falling in a resistive medium. In this particular case, we have an object on the surface of some water, and we're just going to let it fall. Through the water, there'll be the force of gravity, which of course is why it's going down to begin with, but because of the water, there's going to be a drag force, a resistive force. This is akin to the same problem as jumping out of a plane. The air there is the resistive medium, and gravity is going to pull you down, but the same sort of features of the problem there. Okay, so the Newtonian prescription for making your model is the mass times the acceleration is the force. So you have to identify the forces on the body, which I have, so gravity acting down, drag acting in the opposite direction to which the body is going, and I've set up a coordinate system X measured positive from the surface of the water going down. So, the mass times the acceleration. Acceleration is the second derivative of position. And now I have to identify the forces and write them with the right signs. F grav is down, which is the same as the positive X direction. And then I've got my drag force. And now, I need to know something about the nature of these forces. So the standard gravitational force is it's the mass times the acceleration due to gravity. You're told that this is 9.8 meters per second squared. And now a very common model for drag is to say that it's proportional to the velocity. Now in this particular case, you're told that the gravitational acceleration, sorry, the drag acceleration is kV, and k is 10. Okay. So you can see that I can get rid of mass everywhere, and you can also see that I've sort of mixed up things here. What is V? V is my velocity, x dot. And x double dot is V dot. So the next thing I'm going to do is make this one differential equation in V, and I'm going to cancel the masses from the other side. So now I have this. Let me write it out using a derivative. That's my differential equation. I'm hoping that you'll recognize that it's linear, first order linear. Remember, the important thing with first order linear is to identify an integrating factor. Notice that I'm not putting the numbers in. We might put them in at the end when we want a numeric answer, but it's almost cleaner not to involve them right now. So the integrating factor is e to the integral of k dt. So e to kt. And remember, the point about an integrating factor is that you multiply both sides by the integrating factor, and then the left-hand side becomes the derivative of the integrating factor times the dependent variable. So this is what I have. This is true. I want to find V, so I'm going to integrate both sides with respect to t. So that means over here, I have to do this. My arbitrary constant. So we're up to here, and now I want to solve explicitly for my v as a function of t, so I'm going to multiply both sides by e to the minus kt. Now, I've got one arbitrary constant here, so I need to look for some information that's going to enable me to figure out what this is. Remember, we were told that the ball is being dropped from rest, and so that's just a fancy way of saying that initially, at time zero, the velocity was zero. So that's the information that I need to put in here. So V naught
equals naught tells me that naught is equal to g on k plus c, because when I put t equals naught in here, I'm going to get 1. So therefore, c is equal to minus g on k. And now I can write down the solution. All right, so now we have the solution of our differential equation. Let's have a little look at it and think about it. So what have we got here? We've got a decaying exponential. K is positive, in fact, k is 10. I'm going to put the numbers in the middle. But let's just remind ourselves, for instance, what does e to the minus kt look like? Well, at 0, at t equals 0, it would be 1. And then it would be decaying monotonically and coming down towards 0. So the biggest value of this is 1, and then the smallest value asymptotically as t goes to infinity is 0. So that means that this number here in the current setup is actually growing towards 1. Yeah? Because at t equals 0, this is 1, and that is consistent with our v naught equals naught, and then as t gets bigger, this gets smaller, so this number here gets bigger, and so we approach the number g on k. And that's an important number. That's the terminal velocity. So the limit as t goes to infinity of vt is called the terminal velocity. And from what I just explained, this is going to be g on k. Okay, so up to now I've done everything without putting the numbers in. But if you look at the solutions, you'll see that they just differ from this because we've gone and figured out g on k, so this is 9.8 on 10, or if you like, 98 on 100, or if you like, as expressed in the solutions, 49 on 50. Okay. So there are answers, but I think sometimes it's better to almost do things with the symbols so that we don't get sort of caught up in the arithmetic. Okay, so let's look at part C. Everything is flowing now from the knowledge of this solution. So part C is saying, how long is it going to take before my velocity is 95% of my terminal velocity? Okay, so in other words, I'm telling you this is the velocity that I want to achieve, and I want you to figure out the time at which I achieve this. So, as I said, this is an exercise in just plugging into the solution. We can cancel our g on k's. I might go over here now. And so what do I want to do here? I have e to the minus kt is going to be 1 minus 0.95, just manipulating both sides of this equation. I'm going to take logs of both sides. And so this is going to be log of 0.05, which is 5 parts in 100, 1 part in 20. If you don't like this minus sign here, you can remember our log laws. And this is log of the reciprocal of 20. So I can do that and get rid of that minus sign there. And so this is the time that I'm after. This is the time for which the velocity has reached 95% of the terminal velocity. So the picture in your head is the thing was released at rest, it's falling, it's gaining velocity, and we've figured out the time at which it's going to hit 95% of the terminal velocity. And after this time, it's just going to keep gaining velocity, but it very slowly now, because of this tail in time, t till it eventually, sort of asymptotically, it's going to get to the terminal velocity. So this is the answer for part C, if you want to put 10 there. All right, so now we move on to the last part of the problem, which is part D. And the main thing going on here is to imagine that we started with a different initial condition. So I have to remind you of the equation that we derived earlier before I replaced C. Okay, so here was my arbitrary constant. And previously when we had the object drop from rest, I used V naught equal to naught here, which made this one, to tell me that C was minus G on K. Now I'm being told something different. I'm being told, well, imagine you actually initially put a velocity on it that was bigger than G on K. What's going to happen? If T equals zero, then whatever V zero is, I just put that in here, and so that's what C is. So that means I can write out the solution again. And this is for any initial condition now. And now, if you were told that initially your initial velocity was bigger than g on k, then you know that this is some number that's greater than zero. So what's going to happen? We need to remind ourselves of this decaying exponential. T equals zero. E to the minus kt was 1, and then remember, it just monotonically decreases, going to 0 from above, asymptotically. So what's going to happen now is that at t equals 0, this is 1, and you're going to start with a velocity that's bigger than the terminal velocity, and then as time continues, this is going to become a smaller and smaller positive number, asymptotically going to zero. So the result is that here, the speed decreases to g on k from above. Okay, and compare that to what happened in part A, where the speed increased to g on k from below. Started from zero and then went up and hit the terminal velocity. In this particular case, you'll start with a velocity bigger than the terminal velocity, and then you'll fall, the velocity will fall till you hit g on k, at least asymptotically in time. And that completes the problem.